Yeah, okay, like everyone in the world, I kinda wanted to talk about Squid Game. About 2 days after its initial debut on Netflix, I came across it while browsing and decided to watch it, and didn't stop until it was literally over. The series was gripping, suspenseful, and had a knack for keeping you on the edge of your seat while not making it feel drawn out. The end of episode cliffhanger isn't new, and when done wrong can easily make you feel annoyed, like the show is trying to trick you into watching the next episode. But Squid Game wasn't like that. The characters, the story, and the pace everything was playing out at was so well done, it captivated the entire world, not even metaphorically speaking. It managed to turn a 9-episode series, with each episode being about an hour long, into feeling like it was a 2-hour movie. But what made Squid Game so popular? Why is it such a good series? Well, today, we're gonna talk about that. By the way, I apologize in advance if I completely butcher the pronunciation of any names I'm about to say throughout the video. Also, there will be spoilers ahead. I'm making this under the presumption that you've already watched it, so I don't have to recap everything that goes on. So if you want my recommendation, watch it. It's totally worth it. So with that said, let's continue the video. The series was created, written, and directed by Hwang Dong-hyuk, who initially developed the script back in 2008 when he himself was in a financially bad situation. He read books like Battle Royale, Hunger Games, Liar Game, and Gambling Apocalypse Kaiji, which each respectively deal with the topics of poverty, money, and/or competition, each with varying degrees of danger. These all helped inspire him to create a story of his very own. He wanted something that would serve as an allegory about modern capitalist society and its hyper-competitive nature. It, in and of itself, is an extreme competition, one that you're fighting for with your life. He wanted to tell his story not with hyperbolic caricatures of people, but rather actual people, ones that we've all encountered or could encounter in real life. His story would revolve around children's games and the irony of making them a competition where people's lives are at stake. When you're a child, such competition is hardly important and often not relevant, so forcing a bunch of adults to participate in such is part of the irony. The central game he chose to work around was Squid Game, a very popular Korean children's game from the 70s and 80s. I have no shame in admitting that it never really occurred to me that other cultures had different children's games. I initially thought Squid Game was made up for this series, though it didn't take me long before I realized that it was just a cultural difference. Initially, the series wasn't actually called Squid Game, it instead went under the title Round 6. You could see why it changed. Back in 2008, this type of storyline was considered too bizarre and unrealistic, and because of that, Dong-hyuk had a hard time finding someone to produce the project, and because of that, it just faded away. Until 2019. With the passage of time changing, so too did the outlook on his subject matter. It was no longer considered as ridiculous or far-fetched as it used to. So many people play games with the stock market, cryptocurrency, real estate, all games aimed at making money. People work tirelessly and endlessly to climb up the social ladder, and so his story went from bizarre to slightly fun and realistic. Changes did happen from his original concepts. Initially, the game was supposed to have 1,000 participants all competing for a measly 10 billion won. But 10 years later, that sum of money seemed kinda small, so he raised it up a bit. After looking up the biggest lottery winnings ever, he found someone who received 40 billion won, and so slightly raised the prize pool above that. He also cut down the number of contestants. Also heavily considered were the games that were going to be played. Dong-hyuk always intended for his story to be viewed by an international audience as well. Had he stuck to very obscure Korean games, it would have garnered an audience that would appreciate it, but he didn't want to limit the story's reach, and so he carefully considered which games would serve his game of death the best. There were a few factors taken into consideration: ability for the game to be understood, excitement, and tension the games would provide. Things like jump rope and even knitting, is that even a children's game, were considered at one point but ultimately scrapped due to the lack of tension and excitement those games would bring. When they say first impressions are important, it's very much the truth. A first impression can easily hook you and make you immediately invested, and it's the same for the opposite. If a show fails to make an impactful first impression, you might find your attention wandering elsewhere, likely to your phone. And that's why the choice of Red Light, Green Light was brilliant as an introductory game for not only the characters, but the audience. The game was chosen to be included due to its potential to have many losers in one go, where everyone in-universe believes they are involved in nothing more than a simple kids game where they can earn millions of dollars, quickly gets turned on its head when they realize their lives are at stake. As a viewer, you too have just watched hundreds of people get mowed down by this creepy doll, and too feel the sense of shock. It quickly morphs into intrigue, which is good because you don't want to feel the genuine shock and trauma something like this would induce. But that feeling of what's gonna happen next lingers within your gut and does so throughout the entire series. Tension is this series' specialty. Throughout all six games, Red Light, Green Light, Honeycomb, Tug of War, Marbles, Glass Stepping Stones, and Squid Game, all of them keep you holding your breath without even realizing you're doing so. The brilliant thing about the concept of Squid Game is its premise. Not innately the idea itself, though it is also very clever, but by having the story focus so heavily on the games itself, the story doesn't actually have to spend time on the games themselves. By that, I mean these are children's games, a lot of which people have played, and if not, the concept is fairly easy to understand. So the screen time isn't eaten up on trying to get the audience to understand what's happening, and is allowed to instead focus on the characters. Without these characters attached to it, I don't think the show would have gotten nearly as popular as it did. Yeah, the games themselves are very interesting, and what a lot of people will talk about, but it's the cast of characters which truly invest you. Our main character is Song Gi-hun, a chauffeur and gambling addict who lives with his mother and is struggling to financially support his daughter thanks to all of the debt he's accrued. Something that was very important to establish with Gi-hun's character was why we should be rooting for him. His life is in the dumpster, he has no stable income, he's addicted to gambling, and his home life isn't so great either. You could say that it's because he's the underdog, but theoretically, everyone is the underdog trying to beat the system. So it became a point to showcase why exactly we shouldn't hate him. And it was done so through more passive and subtle scenes, things like feeding fish to a stray cat despite not having much to provide himself shows a more kinder, selfless side. Sometimes these actions would even come through by accident. During the scene where Gi-hun accidentally runs into Sebyok and they collide, both being knocked to the ground, Gi-hun, despite being actively chased by goons, still takes the time to pick up her coffee and apologize to her before running off. Yeah, Gi-hun's got problems of his very own, but he's still considerate towards others. And the best thing about this scene was how improvised it was. The two were always meant to clash and fall on the floor, but what happened within that was all ad-libbed. Picking up her coffee and handing it back to her is pretty ridiculous and funny, so much so that even Sebyok's actress begins laughing the moment he hands her back her drink because, yeah, it's kinda silly. And the scene was kept in because of how in-character the whole thing was. And that pretty much encapsulates the kind of person he is. Cho Sang-woo I would describe as someone who's come to believe his own lie. He gives off the perception that he's rich and successful. He's clever than most, despite being in just as bad of a situation as all of them. He's the most morally conflicted character. He's not cold-hearted like Deok-soo, nor is he as generous as Gi-hun. He battles between what is the smart decision versus the right one. While throughout the series we're often exposed to his darker side, other moments were put in to show that he does still have a heart. One of the first times being when he gives Ali bus money to return home. The two are equally as poor, if not more so in the case of Sang-woo. But he still feels it's the morally right thing to do and lend him a helping hand. It still feeds into his perception of being above others, living via the tradition of noblesse oblige, in which it is the inferred responsibility that the privileged act with generosity towards those less fortunate. He lives the lie that he is successful. And when you see his mom, it's even more sad. She's so supportive and loving, and Sang-woo just doesn't have the heart to tell her the truth about his life. He'd rather keep her under the perception that he's successful and she has a son that she can be proud of, versus the harsh reality. When he returns back to the real world in episode 2, we really get to see how far into his perception he lives. He calls his mother for the last time, intending to kill himself, but before he does, puts his jacket back on. It is his idyllic, perfect state, the state in which he wants to be remembered, and the state he wants to go out. That is, until he is reinvited. You get glimpses of Sang-woo's heart, though I'm sure by the end, people don't care. Oh, but who was my absolute favorite and many people's standout character? Kang Sae-byeok, the North Korean defector who entered the game to pay a broker to find and retrieve her family members who are still in North Korea. I think what draws so many people to her initially is that she's more than meets the eye. She has a rough and cold exterior, but paired with having a heart beneath it all. The way she acts, her demeanor, it's so cool and I can't get over it. She really feels like she goes through a much larger arc than most. It's made clear very early on that she's entering the competition for the sake of her family, so you know she's a good person. But she never quite exhibits that side of herself to others. It's like she's tried to distance herself off emotionally from the game to make victory as simple of a path as possible. If everyone is her enemy, then she'll have no problem walking past their corpses. So seeing her slowly get more comfortable thanks to Gi-hun feels really nice to see, even though it may be a double-edged sword. But don't worry, we'll continue on with these three main characters here shortly. And now I want to talk about the supporting cast. Since Squid Game was originally planned as a movie, some characters came to fruition after everything was reimagined as a series. The character of Hwang Joon-ho was one of them. On the search for his missing brother, he sneaks his way into the game and serves as the audience's eyes to the machinations behind the scenes. Through him, we get to witness the world of the masked men as well as the people who fund the game. I felt kinda bad for him since he really doesn't get to interact much with the other actors. I also don't think he's dead, but that's not really part of this video. Il-nam, the old man who's already on his deathbed but is the seasoned expert in children's games, you root for him because he's so sincere and likable until the final episode. Deok-soo made a really good internal antagonist. He'd lie, cheat, and steal his way to a victory if he could. I won't lie, I was actually getting really excited when he wanted to use his gangs to track down the people behind the game and raid them, but that idea was quickly shot down. Abdul Ali was the single most innocent and pure soul I'd ever seen. I was like, it's not worth it, man. You have a wife and a child. You don't need the money that much. Leave with your life. Han Min-hyo, I actually found very annoying. Certainly not my cup of tea, but the actress did a very good job at being her. There wasn't any performance I was let down by, especially when it mattered, which I'll get to here soon. I would say that the only time I thought the acting took a dip was when the Americans showed up. Perhaps it's because I actually can speak the language that it stood out so much, but these guys, oof. Alright, pretty much every episode is great, and I could spend a lot of time talking about each one of them individually. But there's one episode in particular I wanted to highlight for this video, and that's episode 6, Ganbu. God, does everything just lead to episode 6. All three main character stories and paths are tested in this one episode, and somehow it manages to make each one of them its own individual heartbreaker, each with their own theme and ultimate purpose: friendship, betrayal, and sacrifice. All of the main characters' themes are tested here. Sang-woo's is about betrayal. We've witnessed as he's been teetering on the edge of his determination to win. Up until this point, a lot of the things he'd done had been quite questionable. However, early on, the games allowed for teamwork. Others were able to be sacrificed to advance those he'd allied with. But as the numbers became whittled down, that plan of attack slowly failed him. He couldn't outsmart the game, something he'd prided himself on throughout his run. He's losing fair and square to Ali, who himself feels guilt over the prospect of killing someone he'd consider a friend, and it inevitably leads to Sang-woo finally stepping over that metaphorical line, and he betrays Ali. Probably the most innocent and pure of all of the characters, betrayed in a manner which is the most devious, believing them to be friends, trying to work together so neither of them had to die. He was given hope, only to be stabbed in the back. This was the event that tipped Sang-woo's scales of good and evil into favoring evil. Gi-hun's theme is different. Sang-woo was his descent, but Gi-hun's was about friendship. He always had a kind and good-hearted nature to him, even when it came at his own detriment. He chose to believe in others, not to a naive extent, but in a manner which was unlike everyone else. But during this episode, he truly becomes faced with the prospect of death, and it gets to him more because he thinks he won't even get a chance to fight for it. Il-nam, whilst having started out as a strong contestant, has slowly begun succumbing to his sickness. He's reached a point where keeping him around is just out of kindness, but it's obvious that he won't be the victor of the entire game. And during the game of marbles, he exhibits signs of dementia, and Gi-hun is forced to test his moral character under the toughest of conditions. Is he willing to honorably lose at the game of marbles under a fair situation, or is he going to take advantage of the old man's memory loss so he can save himself? And we watch as he chooses the latter. And it is so heartbreaking to watch because we see that he takes no joy in it. Every time he lies to his friend, it kills him inside, and as a viewer, it kills us too because we know that this isn't who he is. The situation forcing him to be a bad person shouldn't define him because we've seen who he's proven himself to be, not who he's being forced to be. As it would turn out, Il-nam was fully aware of Gi-hun's deception and was tricking him the entire time, but regardless, he gives up his last marble because they are friends. A situation which only works because of Gi-hun. It is only because he is the person he is. Everything that he's done, he genuinely considered him his friend, and it is unlikely that Il-nam would have given up his marble for anyone other than him. And then there was Sabiok's story. Where the hell did this come from? Everyone else was paired with someone we've spent some time with and knew, even if it were only so basic. But Sabiok was paired with Jiyoung, and I don't know how it was even possible to both form and rip away a bond so fast and effectively. The character of Jiyoung had served a very minor role up until this point. She was roped in with the main cast during episode 4, Stick to the Team, and was almost a mirror image of Sabiok. Her emotionally distanced, nonchalant attitude allowed her to stand out amongst the crowd. But regardless of her limited on-screen time, episode 6 makes the most out of it. During the game of marbles, instead of playing, they decide to simply talk to each other. We learn more about the girls' backstory, as well as what they do with the money if they won. We learn that Jiyoung saw her father kill her mother, and after being abused for so long, she killed her father. She just got done serving her sentence when she joined this game. And it is here where the true contrast between the two girls is formed. In a game where everyone else immediately began playing for the sake of life and death, almost eager to kill each other and or save their own lives, they are the only two who don't. The scene was designed to show just how truly innocent the two are in a sense. They are complete strangers, but through their limited time, come to understand each other, empathize, and be human in a game which otherwise demands the opposite. Initially, Jiyoung was thought up as a boy during the story's creation, however was changed to a girl as the relationship between the two felt more natural. And I couldn't agree more. What makes this scene work isn't only this scene itself, but also the common ground the two shared prior. They met during the tug of war game, and when explicitly told to find male players, Sabiok did the opposite. She found a loner on the outskirts. Right from the get-go, the two shared in the perception of weakness. Being both girls in a game of tug of war, they were seen as liabilities. From the very beginning, the two's bond had essentially already been formed, and this idea doesn't work strongly under the original concept of Jiyoung being a boy. And when they inevitably decide to play the game, Jiyoung all but forfeits her life so Sabiok can live on. Jiyoung, after hearing her story, realized she really has nothing, nothing to continue fighting for. But Sabiok does. Her brother, her family, she's putting her own life on the line, not for herself, but for others. And that was ultimately the reason she happily gave up her own life and did so with a smile. It's amazing how well, in such a brief period of time, the writing was able to have them be vulnerable and humanized as well as forming a meaningful bond that draws out such a visceral emotional reaction from the viewers. And sacrifice was ultimately the theme of Sabeok's character. She herself is not competing to save her life like everyone else. She's competing for her family. She's using herself as a sacrifice in hopes to give them a better future. Jiung's sacrifice was very fitting for the character of Sabeok.
쪽팔린 게 문제야? 난 무조건 이겨야 돼.
그럼 나랑 해. 내가 무조건 이기게 해줄 테니까.
무슨 수로?
무슨 수를 써서 돼.
And that's really what episode 6 does so well. So much of what the characters were leading up to boils to this exact moment. None of the stories feel the same because they all had their own unique purpose. This episode, I have no qualms in saying, is the best episode in the series, and it fucked me up. The confrontation between Gi-hun and Sung-woo is quite good. While for the audience, Sung-woo's tipping point happened after he betrayed Ali, the others quite frankly have no idea what transpired. Everyone carries their own baggage from that game. But for the others, it was pushing the glassmaker to his death which showed them just how far he's fallen. It doesn't become a battle of good versus evil as it was with Deok-su. It instead becomes a clash of perspectives. Sung-woo believes he has made it as far as he has thanks to his own genius and cleverness. He has earned his position. While Gi-hun believes the opposite. He doesn't just think, but he knows that if it weren't for others, he would already be dead. Sung-woo's beliefs are founded in fact, however. If not for his quick thinking during the tug-of-war game, and if not for him pushing the glassmaker during the glass tiles, they would all likely be dead. So it makes his justification for his own actions quite believable. He always finds a reason, whether or not we may like it, that makes sense to him. But at the same time, the glass stepping stones game was designed to reinforce Gi-hun's outlook over Sang-woo's. As to reach the end, you must literally step over the bodies of the dead who have forged a path for you. If not for the others, your chances of making it to the end are nigh impossible. And it's upsetting because Gi-hun has witnessed Sung-woo's fall from grace. When the game started, he actually tried to give advice and help his friend make it through, but as they went on, he would indirectly not help them out. If Gi-hun died during the honeycomb game, blood wouldn't directly be on his hands as he made the decision himself. He worked with the others and tried to help them get through if possible, but as the games progressed further and further, he got blood on his hands. It was him who winds up directly killing others. And that's what makes his betrayal against Ali so perfect. There is no justification for what he did. There is no moral workaround to convince himself otherwise. He knew what he did and chose not to face it. And so he is forced to lean into the idea that he's smart and clever, not that he's a good person like Gi-hun. Him making it to the finals and serving as the antagonist is so much more impactful than if it were, say, Deok-su. Also, I'm gonna throw this in here, it's kinda bullshit that they blew up the room and Sabeok got impaled by a piece of glass. Theoretically, more than two people could have made it to the Squid Game. It didn't have to be a one-on-one. She got screwed over. I'm just saying. I just want to take a quick moment to also compliment just how amazing and well thought out the creative design that went into the series was. From the M.C. Escher-inspired staircase to the masked men made to look like worker ants, even with the mask reminiscing that of an ant's face, to the layout of the beds arranged to represent life's competition like a gladiator's competition, and desire to climb the social ladder. Everything was given a vision and its own story, even if never addressed. The reason the coffins have a bow wrapped around them, for example, was added because the art director thought that the mastermind would have had a god complex, and that even in death he is gifting them his mercy. And what's even more impressive and something I hold so much respect for are the pictograms that are on the walls. Every game the characters played and or were going to play was always there. They were just blocked by all the beds. So the more and more people who died, the walls opened up. But none of the characters ever noticed or call attention to this, and to put that amount of detail into something that's not going to be acknowledged in the show is admirable. Choi Kyung-sun killed it. And I probably butchered your name, I'm sorry. If there was one thing I was pretty meh on, it was the ending. I don't think it was bad, but I'd equate it to vanilla. It's what you expect to happen and was the build-up to what the story was leading to, with the exception of the twist that Il-han was the mastermind all along and didn't actually die. He believes humans to be corrupt and Gi-hun wins, representing the best of humanity not having to stoop to immoral actions, aside from that one time. The messaging is there, and having a quote-unquote predictable ending and victor isn't bad. Though I can easily see there having been a potential alternate victor in the form of Sabeok. She really was the character who went on the biggest journey and developed the most change throughout it. She had a meaningful sacrifice, which makes it feel really bad that Jiyoung died for nothing. In reality, Gi-hun returned to a life of nothing. Despite having won, his mother was dead, his child had moved out of the country, and for over a year, he did nothing with the money. I get feeling guilty that it's all blood money and would be disrespectful to use, but at the same time, Sabeok tried to get him to make a promise to help each other's families whoever won, and he didn't do that for quite a while. Nor did he agree to it when she was pleading with him, whilst she was literally dying. It makes sense that he's the victor, yet he never seemed the type to be able to handle what winning entailed. He does represent the best of humanity, but part of that also includes pushing others above yourself. I think the series could have easily achieved the same message and similar end result, but with Sabeok as the winner. I don't know, maybe my bias is showing, but she was the best. In the end, Squid Game wasn't a story about heroes or winners for that sake. It was meant to be all about losers. For others to succeed, there must be those who fail. Even in victory, Gi-hun still feels like he lost. He feels like the person he was, the person who entered the competition, died in there with the rest of them. It's why he changes his appearance, because he needed to feel like he was reborn in his fiery red hair. However tacky he may look, signifies his anger and rage that he's now channeling to fight against whoever's behind the games. But despite being all about losers, it's also about humans, who we are, and our desires. Everyone we watched wasn't meant to be a character, they were meant to be real, feel like people we all know and would encounter, and that was the show's greatest strength. It invested us in the people. We could empathize, sympathize, and even relate to everyone. And that's why Squid Game was so good.